So, as I've said, we are reviewing the indications for amputation, a very sensitive, difficult subject. Because people went out there good-hearted and were, you know, working to the best of their ability. It's so easy to criticise after the event, and we certainly don't want to criticise. So we've got to navigate through a difficult area to say, to try and get a handle on the issue and how we might improve it in the future if there is a problem. And I expect there is an underlying problem. So as I say, we're doing that study. We do need to professionalise it. This was a survey done by American surgeons of American NGOs offering surgical support in a development role. And they observed that this really was not as coordinated, people as trained as it should be. And that's the big issue we need to tackle now. That we have to make people accountable. It's just in the interests of fairness and justice, we have to operate to standards in another country as we would do at home. Of course, things are difficult in emergencies, but that's, we still have to strive to maintain standards. We're working with the Harvard Humanitarian Initiative, who are also looking at this issue amongst the American agencies that went there. They're particularly focusing on amputations, and we're contributing to that survey as well. And in the UK, which will be my final point, I know we're running out for time, we are finally implementing an initiative that, in fact, we were just talking before, Mukesh and I worked on 10 years ago now, but it's, things take time in the UK government bureaucracy to come to fruition. But that there will be, starting in the new year, a register, a UK register endorsed by the Department of Health, the National Health Service, and the Department for International Development, that those working in the National Health Service who wish to volunteer for this type of work will put their names forward for this register. It'll be all-encompassing, it's inclusive. Your name will go in the register and we will look at your CV. We will then direct you to appropriate training courses. Some will need very basic training courses, some will need more complex training courses, and we will develop our own training courses as well. We want people who do this work to see it as in a professional capacity, something which they will build expertise in, that they will get training in. So there are lots of courses run by NGOs and bigger agencies in the UK where we can send them on for, to learn about how the UN works, how different NGOs work, and so on. We've got our own internal course on emergency humanitarian assistance, which we will direct people to. There is also a diploma in the medical care of catastrophes that we run in London. We'll direct people towards that. And with the Professor of Plastic Surgery, we're going to run a special course for plastic and orthopaedic surgeons on the management of these injuries. And in any of those areas where we could work together, I would be very enthusiastic to do that, because I know particularly on the surgical front, great initiatives have been made by the Red Cross, and we would like to work in support of that, particularly getting... There are models in the management of trauma, the Advanced Trauma Life Support course, which is taken universally now, which gives you the basics in the management of acute trauma. We need to develop something similar for the management of these injuries, a short course that will give you the basic principles in a short period of time. And these principles are agreed by everyone. And this register will maintain the current availability, obviously. We'll check that there people are ready to go. And we'll identify core competencies. And that's where we need to consult widely. We want to make sure that what we are saying our core competencies are shared by everybody. This is inclusive. We want to make sure it represents everybody's views and that everybody, the big agencies, can buy into this. It's not us saying, this is what we believe. We have experience, but lots of people have lots of experience, and we need to get a consensus on this. I know WHO here in Geneva are looking towards this as well, and I'm sure we could all come together and get some very effective guidelines. And from the UK perspective, we will liaise with the managers The managers in the NHS are very keen for their staff to volunteer for this type of work. They see it as altruistic, and they see it also as actually good for their personal development. What they are concerned about, though, is they want to make sure the right people are going. How do they know that it's the right person that's going? And also, they don't want the whole of the plastic surgery department in one hospital to go to Haiti. They want to spread it around. And so they're very supportive of the register for those logistical reasons, that we will make sure that only the right people go. They can actually legitimately say no to people. I want to go take time off work to go to wherever. Are you on the register? Well, if they're not, well, get yourself on the register, get the training, and next time you can go. And that they will also know that that people going are appropriate, and they will be doing appropriate things when they're there. Again, there is this issue of how long people can be away. 2 to 4 weeks is not very satisfactory, but we have had to negotiate with the employers to find a figure that doesn't frighten them off. And that's fine. And what we've said is that that's what they will sign up to. But if it can be 4 to 6 months, well, they will decide that at the time, once the person has been released. But they want to sign up to something that they know that they can deliver on. So I do have some concerns about the limited time that people can go, but it's a start, and we will see how it develops. So as I've said, I think what we need to do now is to progress to international guidelines. We need joint recognised training courses, particularly from my point of view, on the surgical approach to these injuries. So we're all, people are all in agreement on it. We have a certain view, but there will be other views, and we need to get a consensus on that. We need to get appropriate data collection for these injuries, just like you were saying, and agreed reporting. I don't know if you're aware of the Utstein model, but we had this problem in the management of cardiac arrest and out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, and that trying to compare figures for survival rates by resuscitation get very difficult, because as you say, well, was it like saying how dead were they when they collapsed? It gets very... So at a meeting in Utstein, there was an agreed set of reporting supported by the American Heart Association. And so all your figures now from the UK, across Europe, across the States, they follow the Utstein format. And it strikes me that the time is right now to get an agreed reporting so as we can compare the work of teams. The other thing that this does, if you get this, it lifts standards. Because people get the form of it, well, maybe we should be doing that. In order to start reporting things, it does of itself set a bar that people have to reach, and it professionalises it. And I'm sure we could work together on that. And I think that is it. Yes?
In terms of the data that you provided, I think it was 300-odd operations.
Yeah, yeah.
In terms of your team, I imagine most, if not all, would have been bloodless surgery. But for the cases where blood was needed, how was that managed in your particular case? And have you seen differences over the last 10 years?
Yes. In fact, we've always assumed... Well, it depends on the scenario. If you are supporting a maintained framework, then the local blood chain will be preserved, usually. In cases where that has not been so in the past, we've assumed we would operate without transfusion. And it can be done. You just have to go more slowly, and you have to cut. You have to tie off every little bleeder. You've got to just... So it's more thorough. We didn't have blood when we first arrived in Haiti. We had one patient who did, because he had, we were trying desperately to save his limb, and in the end we didn't. But we had to have so many operations in which we were clearing stuff out, the muscle was bleeding, he was clearly becoming anemic. We got blood off HMS, American hospital ship Comfort. They helicoptered blood in for us, for him. They were very generous with the supplies that they had. But very quickly, WHO set up a cross-matching service. And so we would take blood off our patient in the morning. They'd set up a laboratory in town where it was cross-matched, and then we picked up the blood in the evening. And it worked very well. But by and large, cross-matching has not... blood transfusion has not been a major feature. But it's like oxygen. If it did become, then you would extend the surgery that you do, but then you get into the issues you were talking about what you leave behind and the standards that you've set.
I know we're running out of time.
Yes, I'm sorry.
First of all, acknowledge a very interesting I really think it's important to hear.
Of course, yes, I'm sorry.
No, it was good.
Once I get going, you can't shut me up.
That's the same for some of us. But I think in the Red Cross, we tend to not see the outside world. So I think one value in your lecture was just hearing that you grapple with some of the same issues we grapple with. Maybe if we can take another 5 minutes, 10 minutes for a few burning questions or comments.
Thank you very much. We have been sending surgical facilities for about 15 years now, and they are called emergency response units. And our biggest concern with earthquakes is that our research and the reviews that have happened say that 90% of people who die of injuries die within 72 hours. So the past 5 or 6 years, it has been squeezing our deployment capabilities to below the 72 hours, so we actually could say that we are trying to save the lives of people.
Yes.
Those injuries. And there is a deadline, there is a wall that we hit, and you can't just get to hospital faster than 48 hours.
Of course.
And you've just said that surgical teams treat a self-selecting team of survivors.
Yes.
Are you saying that we accept that we actually cannot really save that 90% who die?
Short answer?
Yes.
Yes.
Because that would change a whole...
But I would, immediately qualify that with separating out life-saving surgery from limb-saving surgery. And limb-saving surgery is neglected. And limb-saving surgery is extremely important because it might become life-saving surgery with chronic, with untreated sepsis, which develops more slowly after earthquake injuries than it does after war injuries. So there's limb-saving surgery, but the impact of limb-saving surgery on the reduction in disability is enormous. And my experience over the years has been that we underestimate the importance of limb length in getting in a very poor resource country. Because whatever prostheses are available when the immediate aid comes in, they don't last. And when everything settles, they will be relying on very poor prostheses. And in particular for children and young adults, they're growing. And so they will need repeats. So the better stump that you can get, the more functional limb that you can get, even just the better cosmesis you can get, that is, they look like they've got two legs and they walk like they've got two legs, improves their whole position in employability and in society. So we now think more about limb salvage surgery. Now, I don't want to be too complacent about that, saying, well, you know, you can hang around waiting. But we set it at 48 hours for a number of reasons, some of which are not scientific, one of which is logistic. It takes about 48 hours just to, you know, you can't just go. But we try to do it within that, so it's not any later than that, because by the time that you are in country, then you have to start working if you're going to have an appropriate impact on limb salvage.
On limb salvage, just my other last question is: our surgeons have reported so many what they call re-amputations, and looking at that, this is what you call the guillotine amputation,
yes,
being re-treated for,
yes,
better coverage.
Yeah,
and that goes back to whoever went in the first place.
In the very first place, yes.
Had a Swiss knife and did amputation.
Absolutely.
Pretty much. And,
but what's
think,
in... What's,
do you think we should call for a qualification preventing people from doing surgeries unless they have some sort of international qualification to do surgeries?
I think it... Well, my answer would be yes to that. But the practicality, it's very hard to implement that, but we should have that as our goal. This is why I say we need training courses that bring people together to understand and to reassure them that at the very first stage when you get there, and the feeling of being overwhelmed is terrible. I mean, you know, I think I'm fairly tough, and you know, I've seen a lot of things both in my UK practice and things, but when you see so much around you, the human response is to be overwhelmed. And for surgeons to do the guillotine amputation is a very complex, I believe, psychosocial phenomenon. That they're, in fact, they've got so many to deal with, they just want to do one definitive procedure and finish. And they're partly treating themselves because if I just do this, and I've got to see them again, and I've got all these others. And that. And we need to reassure people that in an earthquake at the very beginning, the need for a guillotine amputation is less than people traditionally think. And that we do have a small window of time in which we could review it. Just cleaning the wound and dressing it and giving pain relief and reviewing them the next day, you will know, within 24 hours, you will know an awful lot more about what needs to be done to that patient.
Maybe one more?
A non-surgical question.
Thank you. It will be surgical. So just a it's a common one question. At the last international conference, we adopted the document that is essentially referring to something that we're talking about, the need for due preparation for the disaster and the register of professionals.
Yes. Yes.
A lot of people who go there with the best intentions, but sometimes the level of professional, their professionalism and the needs on the ground are so different that the sad reality that it may become more of a burden than that.
Absolutely.
So something to share with you there.
Okay.
Works in parallel.
Good. Yes.
To those attention that you have in the specific area of medicine that you're addressing it in larger, in a broader context of all the competences that are needed in these aspects. So we'll be happy to share that.
Thank you. I mean, what you say, you know, people going unprepared without there being a review or a reflection on practice, then they do things because they think they're supposed to do it. In general, people associate earthquakes with amputations, and you go and you will go there and you will do an amputation. So people almost seem compelled in a way, and we have to, you know, if we prepare people more, then it will just put a brake on, just let them step back a bit. And, you know, their amputations will be done. But there's also the care for the patient, I think, that... You see this in day-to-day practice. If you negotiate a bit with the patient before you amputate, they tolerate it far better. Because they always think, did it need to come off? Did it need to come off so high? Didn't it? Whereas the first amputation we did, we tried very, very hard with this young man. And he knew by the end of that. And he knew that we tried really hard, and he knew that everything had been done, so he could tolerate it. And I think there is... you know, just the human element, you just need to negotiate with your patients as well and show that you have at least tried.
Thank you.